Good evening and welcome to the November 4th meeting of the Mayor and Board of Trustees of the Village of Flossmoor. Just a reminder that this meeting is being streamed via Zoom for the convenience of those who are unable to join us in person. We ask that when you're called for a public comment that you approach the podium over here and abide by our board's public comment policy, which includes giving us your name and address, acting with the forum, addressing your comments to the public body at large and not a single member of staff. And please limit your speaking time to 5 minutes per person for a total public comment time of 30 minutes. Thank you so much. The time is 7:31. Clerk O'Gallo, would you please call the roll?
Trustee Brett Scott. Trustee Daggett.
Here.
Trustee Driscoll.
Here.
Trustee Lofton.
Here.
Trustee Mitros.
Here.
Trustee Mustafa.
Here.
Mayor Nelson.
Present. Thank you so much. We have a quorum. First, I will call citizens present wishing to address the board, and the first person on the list is Ashley Giddens. Welcome, Ms. Giddens.
Good evening, Village Board members and attendees. My name is Ashley Giddens, and I'm a resident and advocate for ensuring that the safety of our children is managed thoughtfully and ineffectively. I'm here to provide feedback on a proposal to install cameras at the Homewood Hill detention basin, specifically those that will use AI technology to detect activity in the basin area. While the goal of keeping our children safe is paramount, I would like to highlight a few key points for consideration that I believe are essential for a successful and responsible implementation of this system. Starting with an access alert process and response time. We ask that the village provide clear information about how quickly the AI alerts will trigger responses. Specifically, what will be the process for the initial alert? Who will receive it first? And what is the estimated time for a response team to arrive? Ideally, a safety team or other designated responders, in addition to the police, could also receive alerts to expedite any necessary response time, ensuring that any child or individual in distress is attended to as quickly as possible. Next, a false alarm prevention in AI accuracy. AI technology has great potential, but it also comes with limitations, especially in detecting specific movements. We would like assurance regarding the accuracy of this system and how it distinguishes between children, animals, and objects to reduce false alarms. This accuracy is critical to avoid excessive alerts and the unnecessary deployment of emergency personnel, which could undermine the system's credibility and the community's trust. Moving on to maintenance and security. For a system like this to remain reliable, regular maintenance is non-negotiable. We would like to hear more about the planned maintenance schedule for these cameras and the AI system. Additionally, it's essential to have strong network security to protect against unauthorized access or hacking. As we all know, these cameras will be monitoring a public space involving children, making security a top priority. Fourth, transparency and community feedback. It's important for the village to keep our community informed of the system's performance. I propose regular updates and community feedback forums where residents can provide input on how well the system is working and raise any new concerns or suggestions. I would be more than willing to work with the village to facilitate these discussions and help address any concerns that may arise after the implementation. And lastly, the village, I ask that you please consider any alternative safety measures such as a storm trap system. While cameras may offer a layer of protection, there are alternatives worth considering. The storm trap detention system, for example, is an innovative solution that allows a detention basin to be installed underground, restoring green space above. I have spoken with representatives from storm trap, and they confirmed that it would be feasible to install their system over the current groundwork, and it does not require an underground pump. This option not only provides effective stormwater management, but also eliminates the need for a hazardous open basin. It has been implemented in schools across the country to successfully restore outdoor spaces, providing both safety and usable green space for children. In closing, I urge the village of Flossmoor to think thoroughly about this decision and consider these elements carefully before moving forward. The history of this project shows the risk of rushing to a vote without fully examining the best options for our children and our community. Let's ensure we are all making a well-considered choice that puts safety first and transparency at the forefront. Thank you for your time and consideration of these suggestions. We've met with the principal at the school a few months ago, and we did discuss certain precautions we would like to have in place, and lighting may have been on that list, and this was very long, but what I can do, I can email you the list of items that we have requested from the school.
Okay. Thank you, Ms. Gibbons. Next up is Andrew Perry. Welcome, Ms. Perry.
Good evening. Andrea Perry, speaking as a 37-year resident and constituent of Flossmoor, Illinois. Because the motives behind my public comments have publicly been called into question by the village attorney, I want to refresh the board's memory of what brought me to this point of my attending every regular board meeting since March 18th and routinely making public comments like tonight. I also want to add, I'm not like writing and public speaking. For me to do so is labor intensive, doesn't come easy, and is uncomfortable. It is not my choice of how I want to be spending my golden years. What drives me to do that, which I don't like to do, and don't want to do, however, is my compassion and caring for all people as human beings, and my passion for what is just, fair, and equitable. Prior to March 4th, 2024, I've been a civically non-engaged resident of Flossmoor. However, my viewing of the March 4th board meeting, which displayed the mayor's total non-receptive response, disregard, and discounting of the outpour of the community sentiment in support of Police Darrell Jones, appalled me. I was extremely disturbed by what had transpired. It remains imprinted in my mind. And I decided right then and there to become involved. I knew that I could no longer not be involved. Consequently, I made a commitment to attend each board meeting thereafter and to make public comments on my concerns about how Flossmoor is being managed and run. Because the actions taken by the mayor and village manager seem authoritarian in nature, without transparency, accountability, monitoring, equity, and inclusion. And such leadership and management act to suppress, invalidate, and discredit opposing criticism and feedback. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Perry. Next we have Ms. Jackie Rivas. Welcome.
I'm Jackie Rivas, a member of the Community Relations Commission, but tonight I hope to address you, Trustees, as our resident. Several years ago, the CRC called from the CRC to recommend ways in which the Flossmoor Police could better connect with the community filed residents, closer looking to what happens in the elected police officer. Under the leadership of Acting Chief Taylor and Commander Philkins, 10 of us met every Wednesday for 2 hours from late August to late October. The real headliner, however, was Officer David Lennon. He greeted us every week with the new slate of speakers who were invited to move back many layers of local county and state police. We were introduced to Flossmoor Police Department, of course, but Officer Lennon brought an expert from around the state to inform and educate us about search and seizure, juvenile law, traffic law, 9/11 technology, DUI, interviews, interrogation, special crime units, Miranda rights, and crime scene investigations. One of my favorites was the opportunity to meet the hound dogs that look for people who are lost or missing. And I might add, they're all female, which are reasons for that, which I did like very much. While there are numerous takeaways, there are my five that are specific to our local police department. Many of the officers here are multi-certified, and Flossmoor are police officers not just in uniform. Many are trained in specialties and are often requested to assist in efforts outside the village. If you ask any uniform about their credentials, you get a long list of all their initial qualifications. And if you ask Officer Levy, you'll get a list of his sports achievements in the world of policing, that include golf and baseball tournaments. This police force is uber observant. Most people here watching me just see me talking to you. But I guarantee you that Acting Chief Taylor and any other officer in this room knows where everyone is, what they're doing, what looks right or wrong, and they may even know this from Sox 1 Manage. The third point, the 9/11 Communication Center had been home with a small room full of ponders and low droning noise. Most of the women there come from a long line of 9/11 responders, and seeing them ask probing questions in the calmest way is remarkable. Sensory overload is your thing, take on the visit. Number four, police work is a calling, much like teaching and preaching. This group of men and women are incredibly dedicated to the uniform and dedicated to one another. They back one another up on calls to ensure they remain safe while keeping us safe. And it seems to me that they rarely bite one another. Number five, this last one is just me thinking out loud. At most times, I know there are two officers on patrol. Should there be multiple high priority events, our officers have to determine who gets served first. If you have a domestic, a missing person, and a high school threat, what call do they take? Are there other officers available at that time to help? I just wonder if police staffing is part of your upcoming budgeting process. And if it's not, I hope you will consider the effort of staffing we need to keep our village and our officers safe. And finally, a big thank you to the Flossmoor Police Department, Acting Chief Taylor, Commander Philkins, and Officer Levy for putting together a program that all the Flossmoor residents can learn from. I ask you to continue funding so we can continue to make this course available.
Thank you, Mr. President. I appreciate your comments, and I'm so glad that you took time to be part of that program. Thank you. Next, I have Mr. Byron Walker.
Just one of them going over their experience, guys know that when SWAT teams called, we had that SWAT experience here at Crossmoor. It's amazing. So I have two acts that they did some funding thing that we also funded one of them. So not only for us to and for the officers, but we also, the members got a chance to know each other. The camaraderie that the residents got was impeccable. I got to know a lot of people in the village that I would have never met had it not been this class. And so I ask that you all continue. My last request is that for my Christmas wish, you all did an amazing job with this floor. These seats are terrible for a person my size. So I simply ask that you all invest in some new, more comfortable seats so that my back is not hurting after a knee. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you so much, and thank you for taking time to join the academy. Really appreciate that. Next, we have Pastor Doyle, I think this is. Welcome.
Good evening. Will I enter to on the right?
What?
I want the name to be said by you first, because you would be the one to pull up the minutes from the meeting a year ago, where I was crystal clear as a Marine Corps veteran from what I was. Trader Joe. See, as it relates to businesses in either Flossmoor or Homewood, again, as a reminder, my father was a business owner in Homewood for 15 years, 25 years on East Highway, where comments were made to discredit him due to our race. So, a year later, this statement is different, because if you had listened to the board meetings for Homewood-Flossmoor High School in the last month, you know what exactly is coming. As it relates to race and inclusion and Flossmoor and Homewood, my mother would make special trips out from Beverly to the University of Chicago classmates for the AAA division as a sole African American music major in the 50s. I say that because you're now in November and mental health is different for elderly individuals who now in Cook County have to be focused on property taxes. What's the middle? For those of us who are Marines, and this is a picture of me at 19 as a Marine Corps enlisted, and 35 years later as a clinical social worker, that I asked a year ago that due to the comment about malignability, that attention be focused on elderly individuals, regardless of race, as it relates to mental health, because the holidays are different for elderly in comparison to others. So this will be the first fall where my mother will not be a part of a group of University of Chicago alumni who visit Flossmoor at Homewood and other South Suburban territories with regard to inclusion. The 20th of September, my mother passed away peacefully in Belgium, and as a Christian, I know exactly what my mother is, next to my father, and in the arms of God. However, as it relates to those who are at Flossmoor, and homeowner, and elderly, and focusing on property taxes, and how do I pay bills, to a physical plan, meaning mayor and trustees, for elderly in Flossmoor. This is Flossmoor. I've said the same thing Homewood. Because I'm 54. That'd be willing, one day I'll be 74. And I hope that someone would be concerned about me in November and December, when the holidays are different for the elderly. Because I don't have the resources as an elder that I do for someone who's younger. So the Bible is clear, one to others, finish it because I have 29 seconds left. And I would like for us to think about not just veterans a week from today, Veterans Day, but also the elderly, November and December specifically, because they're not good for
thank you, Pastor. Appreciate you. And if you know somebody who is looking for help, our local townships do a great job with senior outreach, and also HF Park District has a lot of programs. We have a few more minutes left for public comment. Is there anybody else who would like to make a public comment? And if you get a chance to sign in. Thank you. Can I get a motion to approve the consent agenda?
So moved.
Second.
Thank you. Is there anything anybody would like to pull up? Seeing none, clerk O'Donnell, will you please call the roll?
Trustee Brandon Scott.
Yes.
Trustee Daggett.
Yes.
Trustee Driscoll.
Yes.
Trustee Lofton.
Yes.
Trustee Mitra.
Yes.
Trustee Musaka.
Yes.
Motion passes.
Thank you so much. We don't have any special reports for commissions tonight or action items, but we do have a discussion item, and I'm going to welcome Assistant Village Manager Jonathan Bowe here to talk about the cameras at the Heatherville detention base. Welcome.
We're going to start the conversation before Brendan was supposed to be on the video with us today. I'm going to contact him back to see if they're doing it shortly or not. I'm told by 8, so we'll have a little bit of a say. But I'll contact them right now. Here's talk to you today regarding the Heatherville basin camera project or discussion forum. This item was requested by the mayor to take place today. So this started with school district superintendent Dr. Smith contacted the village following the September 23rd meeting regarding an earlier discussion of adding cameras to the basin. Dr. Smith indicated to us that he would like us to discuss it amongst our trustees to see if there was an interest doing something along these lines before back at his board. In those discussions, we talked about quotes and different prices for both going from the school district and having the school district cameras, or the village using their camera provider and that cameras to put them, which is our preferred vendor and something like that. The reason why they're the is currently for a project that's finishing up within Village Hall and doing the other. Both camera companies offer similar technology, and the technology centered around putting cameras to be able to cover that area while monitoring it using the technical measures for the place. So that is what's up for discussion today. This the quote we received was around $25,000 for the lighting. The district is thinking of moving forward for something or pursue something. The district would provide a server space, electricity, access, and roof access for us to be able to do these things. I'll have
charging us for service-based electricity and internet?
No, just, am I understanding the other one? From our initial conversation.
And do you think for the additional $10,000 that's lighting, but does that give us the power on the connection to the servers?
That would be part of it with the roof. It's not a lot of electrical power that can get to cameras, but it's a percent power that we found. So we still can't get the power. But if we went on campus,
will those cameras work at night without lighting? Or do you need to light the basin?
So my understanding, or hopefully we can find out, is that yes. I can hear you, it's coming across really quiet. Your mic's very quiet. Let me see if I can adjust your speaker real quick.
Kevin, can you hear us now?
Yeah, can you hear us now?
Speak one more time. We think we're getting that. Jim stops. Trustee Michael stops talking. We'll be able to hear you one more.
Go ahead and email me your
phone number right now, and I will give you a call on our end and just use the phone.
Yeah, no problem.
So you're good, thank you.
All right, we're going to go low tech. Village manager Rockwell is going to repeat whatever Kevin says. Yes, she does too. Okay. Thank you so much. Trustee Musto.
I believe there are specific reasons to have this discussion. I think if I phrase it as I know more, that's not really what I actually want to say. This is the only retention, only place in Flossmoor that can serve as a school. Levitt does not encircle a school, no other basin encircles a school with children that stay. So you could say that because there are areas around HF that's comparable, but it's not. Those are teenagers. So this is different. For those who haven't visited the basin, please do. It comes right up to the sidewalk. It comes within a few feet of certain windows of the school. It's the only one with this configuration, and it's the only one where young children play in a playground. 35 no more than 40 feet away. So to me, this is different. But what I'm concerned about is perhaps the questions that Attorney Gibbons brought up, and I think they're very well articulated. I need to know more about the technology. My question about the technology is not to say I agree or disagree, I just need to understand the technology. We already know there's a coyote that loves the basin. So we're there when the lights go off, when he or she is there. Or a squirrel, or a dog, or anything moving. Eight turkeys, there are eight turkeys that visit every home in Flossmoor. I'm not making this up. Said my husband was in the yard, and the turkeys came and said, "Hello." This is not a joke. Attorney Gibbons also brought up a good point about if we're not sure what the technology detects, then do we overburden our first responders with calls that add to their workday? And how do we differentiate? There's a house that the gentleman and his family, their house faces the school. Some of their windows face the school. And the wall of their house is within feet of the fence. So lights on the school would literally shine into their house, literally, like into whatever windows are there. That would be unpleasant. Also, there are people who live diagonally. The lights would shine into their fence. So how do we talk through that? Even if it's one resident, for them to have we start now from 6 at 9 until 4 in the morning, a light shine, I don't know. So I think for these questions, I just need to know more about what our objective is, how the technology works, how Crossbow Police will respond, what will they do when they respond? There are just a lot of questions.
So I can talk a little bit about how the alert system works, and then I'll see if we can have you talk more about how it distinguishes between how it identifies people to make sure that people are aware of the squirrel.
And safety of children is our objective, so I don't want to ignore that overriding reason to talk about.
So the alerting system, how it would work, is that it can be set up to either A, call a phone number, or B, text a phone number of an emergency response. So we can have it set up to go to our police emergency line. The videos can then be actually brought up on our video stream at the record clerk, which is always the person on the way to the day. So we can keep there across the street. We send someone there and have a process for that, as well as view those cameras in real time and access to those. That's a possibility as far as the AI technology, having to respond to that, or I can talk through Bridget to have it to talk about what that would look like.
Yeah, so with the cameras that built in AI and the whole camera part pull up on the AI. So it's actually the difference between a human and an animal, so you're not really walk along for based on all the survivors and stuff, so the camera is the difference between a human and the animal. They're not been able to walk on the
how accurate are those in the field, how often you see it identify something that's not a person as a dog or a coyote or what have you, it's a person, because we're also talking about small people too, kids. Can you describe a little bit more of the technology, how it distinguishes between
exhibit cam, but how often does it have miss, you know, misidentifications to a person, you're saying it's the person that drew it, or something along those lines? Question that came up was the lights. Are the lights necessary for nighttime running, or do they have to be part of the package to be able to identify?
Yeah, the lights are additional basic program lights to identify the human being. So this is time parameters, it can be a strobe light.
Kevin, are the lights necessary for the cameras to run at night to identify humans at night?
The extender, how many more feet can you get with the IR extender? Which one? 300 to 500?
So the extenders are are different, you know. So you can have a more expensive extender that gets you in a different way.
Yeah, correct. Correct.
Trustees, any other questions?
So assuming the extenders don't degrade the sideline or the AI's ability, what does that add to the cost? And also, how many lights and extenders would we need around the building for each angle? Like, we know if it's on the north side of the school, it can't possibly apply to the opposite south side or the east side. So how many installations do we need? And what is this $26,000 included?
So the lights aren't included in that package. The lights aren't necessary to turn safely the speakers. We have to get more of a precise answer for what extenders would be necessary and what those costs would be depending on if this was something we want.
I apologize if I'm not looking at the line items, but The $26,000 is paid on what you see on page 50. I just don't know if this is one installation on one side of the building, or is this kind of three sides of the building?
This is the entire, all the cameras, so we have all three sides. The cameras.
Okay. I would like to hear a little bit more confidence in some of the replies regarding our questions. I'm feeling as if there needs to be some confirmation by Quinlan to come back to us and say definitively it's 300 feet or 500 feet or what it is, because I'm not feeling complete confidence.
I know this is an initial discussion before. I'm excited though we could definitely make this into the board process to get a more thorough quote and more information regarding this. Extenders and just Dallas coming.
I'd also like a confirmation. I know 99% accuracy sounds good, but I'd like a more competent response on that too. What is that based on? Is that based upon actually experiencing so many years usage, or, well, it can't be too many years because we're talking about newer technology, but how many installations like this have there been, and how many incidents of errors, so that we know what we're talking about?
Thank you so much. Trustee Bradley Scott.
Thank you. I have some of the same questions that Trustee Misaka has asked and some of the same questions that Peter had asked. But I, to maybe expound on Trustee Mitros's question, is that we are reviewing this because we'll be initially we're looking at this project, there were some safety items perhaps that were not considered, and so because this is a unique project compared to the other detention basins, detention ponds in our area, this gives us a new perspective on how to solve the problem. We heard from the school board members and some parents, we heard from Heather Hill residents terms of their concerns about safety, that when we were initially reviewing the items pertaining to the detention basin, the safety items pertaining being able to see what was down in the basin was not talked about. And so here we are looking at the cameras and looking at what options are available. Although we have Quinlan to talk with us about what their offerings are and how we would hook up with the school, I wonder, is the school on a generator? If they lose power or anything, do they have a backup system, or do we have to provide something for them in order to provide this service?
I'm not sure. It would be something we'd have to work out with the school district. Sometimes on these kind of products too, we have an APC backup or a server backup that provides so much power. For example, we got our servers powered for throughout the generator project, we're going to be hooking up our power here. Based upon some of the battery life too, that's something that we can use a lot. Like a battery backup for something like this for a server, that's pretty standard, something that we have too.
I wasn't quite sure of the response about the AI technology and the system getting accustomed to the objects. Is it that they have to get accustomed to the objects once the new camera system is installed, or that they have objects that they have become accustomed to and they can differentiate between a human and another type of animal?
Kevin,
did
you hear that?
Yes, I
did.
Yes, for the AI,
So Kevin, we need to have to, if this gets moved forward, the thing that we're going to discuss is that technology based upon the DSW server or the software that you guys use, that watchdog software, is that based upon all of its the AI information on how to identify a person or a kid, or is it based upon learning from our environment? It sounds like we're learning from our environment on. So I'm hoping it's the first one. So maybe learning from different angles, we pointed at those different things as well. So there's something that it's learning in the process, but there's got to be a standard base of knowledge it comes from.
So would we, if we train the system, could we have actual individual trained, like a person, a small person who looks like in the field learner or question, so that we can accelerate the system?
I think we need to get some more answers on how the AI stuff works, and if we have to do something along those lines. I think Trustee Bradley's not that we have that information before we go there, and one more training cameras out there. If we actually have to bring kids out there and train the cameras, I think that would be, Kevin, I hope that's not what you were implying, because I'm a little confused too on that. So scaling a fence might be something that learns. It doesn't happen all the time. No, it's learning something scaling a fence. Sorry. No, it's so good.
Yes, yeah, that's the manufacturer.
All of those
to that floor. However, then we look at the area and see what needs to be viewed. So I would imagine the credit perimeter would have to be viewed so you can see it. I don't know at what levels you have to see different things at, and everything else. The cameras that we installed in the village also are like cameras, 360 cameras, depending on what location and where we're hitting them, the people that view they're coming on top of them. So I think there's the newer cameras have a way more capabilities than some of the other stuff we have in the offices as well, but using the record cameras on this thing. So I don't know if I think the extenders are more of it's being concerned with the learning. A portion is being updated, but the cameras itself should have pretty good view from the school. And so, the school district also review different options for cameras as well, using the time they're building as well as TV. So there's they're coming from the as well, according to the rights of some of the knowledge the doctors will share with these school boards at that point. So you can see what their kind of recommendation for the team that they were able to cover the 60% of the things. So there's been a couple of places to
victim of the lights. Trustee Mustafa, concerns and about the lights.
Yes, I'm going to have a question about the lights as well. Especially as it pertains to the fire engines of the neighbors on the two sides of the property. And as pertains to whether or not it's necessary, it sounds like the implement technology is able to do without both being one of the.
Thank you so much. Trustee Day.
Thank you. So I am very glad about this conversation. I am one that probably comes as no surprise. I'd like more conversation as opposed to less. When we were making decisions on the detention area and the concerns came forward from a lot of residents, one of the things that I said, and I meant it when I moved forward, was my intent is to make sure that we can do everything that's feasible to make this as safe as possible. And I stand beside that. So if we can make this feasible, and it's not, then we know it's going to work, and it's something that will ensure that it's safe, even if it only has to be utilized one time, that can be potentially really important. So I'm glad we're having a conversation. I'm still in the middle. I don't know which way I can go, but I think it's worth finding out some answers to some of these questions. So as I understand it, as Mr. Quinlan explained, the lights are not necessary. I do know a little bit about the IR cameras because some of the industry uses them. And they can reach out as far as 2-3 miles. Those cameras are extremely expensive, but to reach 500 to 1,000 feet as well as the technology. So the technology is there, it's not too crazy expensive. Some of the questions that I have on so anytime you have something that we're trying to decide, there's always going to be issues, there's always going to be problems with it. We have to identify what those problems are, and I think with the detention area itself is obviously not ideal. Nice that we didn't have to do it all. But there's issues that come up with that. So with the cameras, there are some issues. My thing is, let's find out what those issues are so we can solve them. Whether that issue is budget, whether it's technology that will work or not. And if we get to a point where it's like, hey, this just doesn't make sense, then I just know that like, if we can solve for those things, it works reasonable. So with that, it looks like the service and maintenance on here, there's a number of $214 per month quarterly, and that's probably just a suggestion from the landlord, what they would imagine that the cost of their maintenance would be, and then once we get the actual equipment we need, that might change. And if we do that, it sounds like that covers the lifetime of the system as long as you're getting that maintenance name, the camera, stops working, and that's a part of it. So some clarification on what that maintenance would cover would be helpful. Generator backup and the APCs are great. If that can be done with that, because a lot of times this would be utilized as just storm, so if power comes out, it doesn't work quite a few. So that's something that would be good to know. It sounds like when the speakers and microphones were a little messed up and they weren't hearing well, it sounds like it's only going to require a single receptacle for each area of the cameras, chassis. But none of that stuff's super expensive, so it seems like there's not going to be a massive draw of power. These cameras don't require a lot of power. It sounds like with the AI technology, it comes with the base programming and it just kind of learns as it goes, which is cool. I don't understand it completely, but some more information on how long it can take for it to really get dialed in would be good. From my perspective on this, I would like to get those answers to those questions and maybe get a more accurate number on what they think the cost actually of this project are. And then we would have to then, in my mind, figure out where it's going to come from, how do we solve that, and then make a decision whether this is feasible or not. So I think this first discussion is good because we're looking at a lot of questions out there. Done very brief moment, rambling, but it's the questions that Trustee Mustafa and Trustee Brad discussed, I would like answers to those, and then a little bit more accurate numbers on what program and installation would actually cost us. Because right now it looks like if they haven't done a site, if they haven't actually been to the site, what was the evaluation? Was it just pictures of the area?
Yeah, I missed that. Yeah, both pictures and drawings and plans, you know, over shots of the areas, the areas. So we were able to add plus all the basic information.
Okay. Yeah, and if they can give us an accurate number based on what we want as far as the extenders and all that, those numbers would be easy to make it easier to make a decision on whether or not to move forward.
I'm going to ask you the same question.
You know, it's
not good. Earlier, how are you going to want the lights?
They're not needed, don't do it. You know, if the reason that the lights are there is a deterrent, I mean.
Yeah, the lights and sound are only there as a chance.
Yeah. To me, it's the notification of someone being in the basin is the thing we're trying to accomplish so that we can have the responders there. It'd be interesting to know, does it also let us know if someone's patient? So it alerts us if they go in, can it also alert us if they leave? So
I would imagine no. I would imagine, you know, it's when the lights are checked the camera, and if there's something in the basin, from a missing technology, you have similarly, there would be no alert saying something.
So we just go off and say, now we have to monitor the containment systems and
respond. Yeah, whatever the process that public safety would have to work out, that hasn't been. We just don't have the capability that can call the police on the road or 911 or whatever the alarm system. So there's probably there's that we have to access as far as what our response is.
Yeah, I don't have any more questions on it. I do appreciate the conversation, and I think anytime something like this comes up, I'm looking forward to having this discussion.
Thank you. Trustee Driscoll.
I come at this a little bit differently, maybe more than the microphone is kind of confusing. I think the discussion of the cameras is completely premature. You have to convince me of the need for the cameras to begin with. We've heard many advocates who are against this project from very exaggerated claims of child safety. For example, I was in one claim that the base would hold 2 million gallons of water 15 feet from the kindergarten. These claims are absurd, kind of on their face. I expect the base is complete. It will be dry 99% of the time, and that when it does get water after a flame, then it's going to drain it out. If we don't get those expectations when the project is complete, then it might be time to reassess whether or not we need cameras to release something. But as it stands now, and I'm willing to have a counter argument with anyone for a discussion. Show me the risk to the kids that is any different than any other case in our village. So I just think it's pretty sure.
Great. Thank you so much. Trustee Lofton.
I've taken notes going up the page on our note sheet of office. I think I've covered everything that the fellow trustees have indicated, including the comments made by Ms. Gibbons earlier, which I think we should take some more time to take a close look at in regards to how quickly the system will alert the police. My question becomes why
something we have to talk to the police and public safety on. I'm not exactly sure on that. That's something that we could work with Carl and other conversations.
The other issue, of course, is the maintenance we can talk about there. It requires, I'm intrigued with that, but just like talked about, I know the sport code of Amazon, this can't be made. It took me 5 tries in the last month and a half to get one sport. So I need to see some sort of demonstration of AI. If just on the film, that would satisfy me. Regarding lights, I'm concerned about the lighting in the baseball field at night because it may entice someone. Just a thought. I realize that lighting does provide safety. But the light up the base is really healthy. One fear that we have. So at this point, if the technology will take care of visually receiving information from someone injured,
thank you so much. To Trustee Laughlin's point, Mr. Quinlan, is this technology set up somewhere where I can bring my dog and maybe a spider or something and dangle it in front of the cameras and see what happens? Because my system at home, a spider crawls in front of it and it doesn't work.
Set up, you can't go into that space. This is a trespassing, and it's always, if you don't have that, then you have nothing to do with it.
Just because someone goes into an area that's not trespassing, then you have to arrest them, you just remove that from it. It's not like real arrest, 6 years old, or one of the
base, 87, not 6 years.
But no, you both are bad.
There's a lot of places.
There are residents that already told me, they don't want, you know, trespassing signs all over the city.
Well, I would say there are consequences somehow. If what we're doing has no teeth, then we can't enforce it. We shouldn't put laws on the books that we can't enforce, but we need a mechanism here to make it not right to go into that space. So that's something.
So when I was a kid,
yeah,
teeth was officer friendly, takes me home and says, your 12-year-old son was climbing to the top of this water tower, which I may or may not have done. And like, here he is. And that was worse punishment. So that, I mean, we're not trying to.
I'm just saying we have to get some type of a mechanism out there to make it. So it's.
Yeah, I think that's part of what we have to figure out is how are we going to handle these situations. And I think some of that is going to be on the services that we put out. And that's the hassle to do that. But that's the part of the discussion we've got to figure out.
You can't weaponize the fence and make it where we would punish the children or others, because what I understand, what is also being discussed is the education behind this detention basin. And so the school district is currently looking at how to educate students on the wildlife, that the plant life that is going to be grown there and different things. So I imagine that a student can be so curious about what they learned, they may want to go back with their parents. So we have to fully look at this from all standpoints before we start talking about how we're going to use this against them.
I'm not saying use it against them, but we have to have a mechanism to let them know that they're not, you know, they're not authorized to go at certain times. If your class is going down, you have a key to the door and you're going and teaching some learning opportunity, that's one thing. But if you're there and you've got cameras all around, that's a different thing. That's what the cameras and the fence are working, people have them. So these are just things we have to think about. So it's not weaponizing anything that's trying to protect citizens. But it's gotta be there for some reason.
We have to fully think it all through and every step of the way, the consequences of, you know, putting the education information out there, when they have access to it, and making sure that we notify the public in terms of what the expectations are, because I can see it going a few different ways. If we are making it such where people have access to it and don't have access to it.
So the only access would be from authorized personnel, alerts, health and safety, school administration. That is it. There will be no field trips inside to the base or anything like what was suggested. Signage on the fence will include do not enter signage for access to these contact public works. Our engineers can put together educational signage as you reference so that if he walks up to the base, we will know about the vegetation and permits and wildlife and towards the additional water that's in the community basin. But there will be signage around the basin and not too much signage, but it will be clear to all sides of the basin. Do not enter any personal information until you can imagine what this project is about.
So Bridget, school administration or our school staff will have the keys to be able to get in?
Yes, the building grounds or personnel will have that.
And why would they need to have access to schools?
Yeah, if the ball gets kicked over or something of that nature, they'll be able to do it.
Well, thank you, Mr. Quinlan. I think there's a few more questions.
vote, we'll be following up with you to get some more information so that the board can make a better decision. All right, we do need to go into executive session tonight, but before we do that, I'm going to call for, I'm going to call for other business from the board. Trustee Musa.
Even though we're in a mission that those resources are available, that we find someone to make it more known to Flossmoor because they are not offered through our village or from partner communities. So if we could, as a suggestion from time to time, make it more prominent, I don't know how you would like to feature it, but perhaps in a newsletter or something like that, because I really don't know how many residents know that there are resources within a short distance of Flossmoor.
Okay, thank you.
So that's all I have.
Trustee Branderson.
I wanted to recognize our veterans for the novel and her mission for the veteran hall that has made trips to the SD-161 school, particularly Parker, and charged the students to do a project honoring the veterans and the wall coming to our area, and it would provide a different conversation, I think, to veterans in our community and their knowledge about this project. So thank you for the work there, and to all of the veterans who are part of our country, thank you very much.
Thank you. Justin.
Yeah, I wanted to just reiterate a big thank you to police and fire for all of the very visible presence you guys had on Halloween. My wife made the comment that Halloween really is the only community holiday where it's expected that you're going to be out and interacting with your neighbors. You get candy, you get the kids, and it really is a community holiday. I can call it holiday. A community event. But I just wanted to say thank you because it was noticed by all of the neighborhoods. I've heard numerous people talking about how grateful they were that your officers were out. I saw Chief Kopeck driving down my street just for you guys to be out there and make sure that the kids were safe and the families were being watched over. Super grateful for everything you guys are doing. So thank you for that.
Thank you.
Trustee Joseph. No questions or comments. I just say, Chief Kopeck drove down my street to try to make him. Let's use that fireman's uniform. We're good to go there.
Thank you. Trustee Lovell.
No comments.
Trustee Myers.
No comments.
Clerk O'Galloway. Bill Turner. Ronald Blaise. Bill Schumacher. All right. Last Friday, with the South Suburban Mayors and Managers Association. We met with President of the Cook County Board, Tony Frederickel. We had property taxes on our mind. All of us very upset with the property tax hike that many of us are facing. The Cook County Board President talked about ways that, actually, we asked her about ways that we can get those taxes lower. One of the requests was made to use Cook County ARPA funding to reduce taxes and also set up a philanthropic trust to help reduce taxes. On a state level, we asked for the property tax floor exemption to be removed and that everybody have a skin in the game, so to speak, so that nobody is paying zero property taxes. Also, State Representative Anthony DeLuca proposed directing money that's going towards migrant services to be redirected to helping with this property tax crisis. And Representative William Davis has been doing some great work to increase state funding for schools. Right now, state funding for schools is about, I believe, 33%, and it needs to be closer to 51%. And he's moved the needle every year on that, and he's increased his efforts. But shifting some of that responsibility on to the state where it should be, really appreciate it as well. Locally, consolidation of services is always a question. A low-remaining group, well, maybe not so low-remaining, but it is a huge effort. And Village Manager Bob Tell is leading the effort to consolidate 9/11 services between Econ and Southcom, which would be helpful. And then we're pushing forward on economic development to help spread the property tax burden among more property owners. And hopefully by the end of the year, we'll have two exciting new developments to present to everybody on Cluster Road and Wilmer Road. So I'm looking forward to that. And also continuing to push on grants to reduce what we're spending on infrastructure and get federal and state help with those needs. And that is all I have. Can I get a motion to go into executive? And have a good night. Thank you so much, everybody, for being here and having that please and to our favorite veterans out there. Enjoying some of us for coming. Can I get a motion to go into executive session to discuss the employment of a specific individual?
Second.
Thank you so much. Clerk O'Gallagher, would you please call the roll?
Trustee Benstap.
Yes.
Trustee Gary. Trustee Driscoll,
yeah.
Trustee Lofton,
yeah.
Trustee Mitchell,
yeah.
Trustee Mustafa. Motion passes.
Thank you so much. Have a great day, everybody.